Good morning, Innovation Church. How are you this morning? All right. Michelle is good. All right. Hey, would you stand with us as we continue to worship this morning?
I was broken and you
accepted and know who I am. I am secure, I'm confident that I am loved and know who I am. It's incredible to know and to be reminded that, you know, we are children of the most living God, amen? And we can trust in him, we can depend on him, amen? Hey, we're so glad that you're here with us today. Welcome, for those of you who are first-time guests, welcome. We appreciate you visiting with us. For those of you who are joining us online, welcome. It's always a pleasure, it's always great when the church, you are the church, not this building, you get that? When the church can get together and we can join together in corporate worship and magnify the name of the Lord. Amen? Because he's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Hey, as we continue to sing another song, earlier this morning, one of the band members shared and he said, hey, I just had a little bit of a mishap this morning. He was in a local store and he wasn't kind to the folks who were serving him. And it was natural that he felt the Holy Spirit, you know, spoke to him at that moment. And it was great. He was in a place where he can hear the voice of the Lord, which is a good place to be. Amen. First and foremost. But secondly, I was just reminded that even when we make mistakes, even when we say things that are not as kind, or you know, when we just go out on the left opposed to, you know, remaining. Focusing on the things that God has called us to do, that God love never fails. That's it. Regardless where we are in life, what we're going through, God love never fails. And so as we sing this song, join us and let's declare that God love never fails. Amen.
Separate sound good. Well, keep singing out. See, I know I still make mistakes, but you have no mercy for me every day. Your love never fails. So you stay.
Said, the pastors and deacons will be available at the front. Whatever you're going through, whatever you're struggling with, you need someone to join with you in prayer to stand in agreement. Remember, God's love never fails. So take this opportunity to come forward and allow your pastors and deacons to pray over you. Amen? After all, we are the church. We are the body of Christ, and we need to encourage each other. We need to lift each other up. We need to stand with each other as we go through things. Amen?
We are the change the world take to your streets. For now's the time for us to rise and carry hope.
Jesus is alive.
let your love be real in this place today, oh God. As we lift our hands to you, oh God, exalting your name. As we lift our voices, oh God, in adoration, be glorified, oh God. Let your love be real in this place today. Come and meet with your people, oh God. Pour your spirit over us, oh God. We exalt your name, Jesus. We exalt your name, Jesus. Come on, church. Let us exalt his name.
We worship you, Lord. You're worthy.
We bless you, Lord.
You're worthy, God. You're an awesome God. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, God. Jesus, you're so great. Jesus, you are so great in this place. So great, oh God. Sometimes words just aren't enough. Sometimes that joyful noise just rises up. Jesus. Yes, God. You're worthy, God. Father God, we love you here in this place. We do lift you up. We do worship you. We do exalt you. You're worthy of praise, Lord God. We thank you for your sweet, sweet presence here in this place. Lord, that your glory is here, that we can sense you, God. We thank you for this opportunity just to be with you, Lord. To abide here alongside you. Lord God, you know the pulse of this church. You know the heart cries of your people. You know what's happening in every person in this room. You're intimately aware of their deepest, darkest thoughts, their worst fears, their deepest pain. Lord, we don't sugarcoat the fact that we're going through difficulties. I don't push it aside that there are people in the church right now that are struggling, that sickness is running rampant, that physical illness and issues of the body are affecting our families. Lord, I can think of several who are in family crisis and who are struggling, looking to you and wondering, what can we do? I can think of others still that are just at their wits' end financially and have bills that cannot be paid. And they don't know what's going to happen. They don't know what the house is, who's going to have it. Lord, there are real fears. Real issues, real problems. And sometimes we don't have words. And we cannot express ourselves in the moment. But again, Lord, as we come to you, as we submit to you, as we seek after you, Lord, I just get this sense that you're doing something here where you rise up. This joyful noise that defies all of that fear, that destroys and denounces the anger. Lord, it rebukes the sickness and the illness of our lives. This joyful noise that rises inside of us. Lord God, and from somewhere in the depth of our being, all we can see, all we become aware of is Jesus. Is our Lord and our Savior risen before us saying, give it to me. Leave it with me. And so Jesus, we leave our fears, we leave our pains, we leave our bitterness, we leave the illnesses, we leave the struggles, we leave the financial issues, we leave all of the concerns of this world with you this morning. We surrender, Lord God, even as we raise our hands, we surrender our lives to you. We give up control. We've tried for a long time and we've just mucked it up. We give it to you, oh God. And we ask, Lord, that just as you've done this morning in this building, that in our lives your presence would reign. That in our lives your glory would be evident. Move, O God. Abide with your children. Take our lives again, O God. Take us, O God. And now, Lord, we're yours. Stripped of all of that mess. Just children. Standing before their father. Singing a joyful noise. Desiring an embrace. Desiring to be with you. And so we are, Lord, here in your presence, here with you. And we thank you. We thank you for what you're doing. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for what you want to speak to us today. Lord, we ask that you would give us eyes to see you and ears to hear from you, O God, as your truth is proclaimed. And so we love you, Lord. And we do pray now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And I would say to you simply, do not fear, for I am with you always. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We worship you. Church, just take a moment to respond to the voice of the Lord, I think. Just stay still in his presence. Just give that small fear, that big fear. Just submit to God and rest in him for a moment. We serve such an incredible God. Yes. Oh, well, church, if you're unfamiliar with what just happened or being around a Pentecostal church, what we had happen this morning is a gift of tongues, which the word says should be followed by an interpretation, which I believe the Lord spoke to my heart simply saying, do not fear, and then followed up again by a word of wisdom from Sister Rosina. The Lord again simply saying, let go. And I've got to tell you, church, it rings so true. It rings so true. I can't tell you how many conversations I've had over the last 2 weeks, phone call conversations and times of prayer and struggle and people in the church that are really up against a wall. And don't know what to do. And so the Lord says this morning, don't be afraid and let go. I'm just going to pray again briefly. Lord, thank you. Lord, thank you for your words to us. Thank you for your truth. Thank you for your strength, oh God, and for your encouragement to us that we may trust solely in you and find our peace, a peace that passes understanding here in your presence. We thank you for that now, in Jesus' name, amen.
Go ahead and have a seat, please. Usually we'll go show a little video and stuff. We're going to do that in just a second. But I didn't say anything in the first worship experience about this, and I wasn't going to say anything in this one at all. I certainly wasn't going to bring it up in this one. Between some of the music and the message and other things that are going on, I thought I'd just share for a moment about something that happened to me last night. And this is an unusual thing for me to talk about, and so I haven't quite unpacked it all, but I had a dream. It was the only time in my life so far that I had a dream that I'm absolutely convinced was heaven. Now, what can I say? You know, when you make a statement like that, you have every right to be incredulous or, you know, just say, you know, someone turn the mic off. But I will describe it this way. I saw things that I've never imagined. The best I can do is try to describe that I was at a lake that I've seen before, but it was like no lake I'd ever seen. The surrounding hillside and everything around the lake was just lush green, but also, again, unique, things that I've never seen before. There was a lot of, and this is going to be tricky, I don't know how else to say it, there was a lot of animal life. I mean, there were creatures that I cannot even describe flying in the air. They were dive bombing me playfully. There were creatures swimming in the sea, back paddling. You know, there was a lot going on, and I found myself on a path walking. And then I said, "Well, why not go for a run? I've got the right sneakers on." What that had to do with anything? And so I started running. And then as I'm running, I'm not in any way tired. I'm not even feeling any. I'm just fully enjoying this run through this incredible, incredible scene with such vivid colors, colors I can't even describe. And I just kept running and looking at everything, and it was almost as if I'd been there forever. I don't know how else to say it. And now I say heaven. I have no idea what just happened to me last night, but I want to go back into that place. It's something that I've, beyond anything I've imagined, and yet more real than anything I've ever experienced in this life. So it makes you wonder a little bit, what is it that would call us to something that we've never experienced? Why even have that desire? Why have it? But last night it happened to me, and there's a song we're going to sing right before I get up to speak. And I can't remember the words right now, but that's the one that's right before I speak. But there's a chorus in it. Do you have the words anywhere? Yeah, heaven is trembling in awe of your wonder. Here in your presence, we are undone. Here in your presence, heaven and earth become one. I wanted to get up and talk about this so badly in the first gathering. There was just something about And I didn't see the Lord. I didn't, but he was everywhere, as well, I'm sure, as one location. But in my dream, but the presence of the Lord was everywhere, and everything was just perfect. The animal, and there was an animal kingdom. That's the thing that now my little dog wasn't there, so I don't know what that means. But I don't like that dog that much anyhow, so it doesn't really matter. No, I'm just teasing. The thing that surprised me is that the diversity of creatures that I saw that I've never even imagined, flying in the air, diving into the water, but everybody was just enjoying that world, enjoying that life. And I just went for a run, and in this body, when I go for a run, I feel it. There, I didn't feel it at all, and I just kept enjoying it. So I was undone. That's all I can say. Something about it just finished me. Now, some of you may be having, and certainly the Holy Spirit is directing us in a way that maybe you're tired. Maybe you were going through some challenges in this life, and there has been some illness that we know of, and there are other challenges that people are facing. I guess I came up here so I could say this. It will all be worth it. It will all be worth it. Now, I think it's worth it here and now, but it's not always for Christians. We go through persecution. There are Christians locked in prisons around the world. There are Christians who have been martyred for their faith. Some of us are going through challenges. It's not always about feeling totally content in this life and content in this world. There are going to be challenges, but the Lord has made us for something far greater. And what we want to do in this world is stay on mission. Keep doing what the Lord has given you to do. And when the day comes, and I'm going to talk about this in my message in just a little while, but when the day comes, he'll call us back, and there's something beyond your imagination waiting for you. Beyond your imagination. I just want to share that with you. Thanks.
Well, we're going to go ahead and keep moving, I think. I want to get to that next song. But to get there, we're going to go through a couple of videos, and I'm going to come back and share some thoughts with you just briefly. So let's watch together here for just a couple seconds.
I can't do anything right. No wonder my boss won't promote me and my wife doesn't respect me. God's not finished with me yet. I can be the man he created me to be at work and at home. I can't believe he's acting like that. What a jerk. He must be having a really hard day. Maybe God put me here to make a difference in his life. I just can't stop doing this. I'm so frustrated with myself. I will always be this way. I can do this through Christ's strength. He will help me overcome. Succeeding at the big things has a lot to do with the little things. Thoughts, words, actions.
I can attend any church I want to.
I can listen to anything I want to.
I can choose any candidate I believe in.
I can say anything that's on my heart.
I can express conflicts I have with the ruling power.
I can start a business,
sell a product,
and live a dream.
These are all freedoms I enjoy.
I engage in these freedoms and I appreciate them.
But the only reason I have this quality of freedom,
the only reason I have the freedom to do any of these things,
is because of this.
This
is because of this. The price of freedom is great.
And today, we remember that price.
Today, we honor people who have gone to their graves in defense of
our freedom.
Greater love has no man than this.
Then he laid down his very life.
For a friend.
Well, good morning, everybody. How you doing? Everyone doing well? Yeah? Good, good. I am finally doing fairly well, doing pretty good. My family has been very ill, very sick. My poor mom is not with us this morning. She's at home in bed, sick, and my kids and my wife are recovering. It seems like everybody kind of this week is falling to pieces. Anybody in here? I just am curious. Who was dealing with sickness in your family this week? Anybody? Just one, yeah, that's quite a few of you, actually. Yeah, boy, something going around. Gotta love it. Gotta love the change in season, something. But here we are. And man, how awesome is it to be in the house of God? Such an incredible morning. It's just nothing like it, you know? There's nothing like being in God's presence. And if today is your first time here with us, if you're a guest with us today, we want to just welcome you, say thank you so much for coming and spending a Sunday morning here with us. You are so important and really the primary reason we're here. And if you came in, you should have gotten a VIP packet when you came in, a big black, you know, envelope looking thing. And inside of it, you should have a card that looks like this. There's a connection card at the bottom here. And if you would do us a great favor of just filling that out with some contact information, a way we can reach you this week. And then at the end of the service, take it back to the VIP table. We want to give you a free CD with some music on it from our worship team and some free refreshments, things along that nature. But ultimately, we want to connect with you. We want to just find a way where we can pray with you and make ourselves available to continue to pray with you in the weeks to come. And so that's really all we want to do and make sure you feel welcome this morning. And for the rest of you, as always, please take that connection card and write your name on it for us. Put it in the offering bucket when it goes by. That'll help us in our attendance. And I'll also make note that at the top of the connection card, you guys know we have this every week, is a little tear-off. And this tear-off has two sides to it, one of which says small things, big difference. That is the next series coming up next week and through June. You saw a little video about it. And I think it's going to be a powerful sermon series about small things, which are so important and such a big deal. It's funny, you know, life is small things. That's just a reality. And so we are going to learn how to master those small things and see God make a big difference in our lives. And the other side says Time Travelers, which is the kids series that's going to be going on through June. So feel free, give that to a neighbor you've been praying for, someone who you want to see come here and potentially experience the love of Jesus Christ. Amen? Okay. The other video we saw, which is just so powerful, and I mean, it's just impossible not to be impacted as we, you know, honor and remember our fallen heroes, and we think of Memorial Day, but I just want to, you know, to you, the congregation, if you're a family member of someone who's fallen and given their life in service, we want to just say thank you. We want to honor you. We want to honor your sacrifice, and that goes for, of course, everybody outside this building as well. We just want to honor them today, and we'll be praying over them here in just a few minutes. Also, for Memorial Day, I want to let you know that we're actually going to close the office, as is typical tomorrow, so don't come to say hi tomorrow. No one will be around, but we'll be around Tuesday, and if you really need us, I'm sure you can call us. One of us will get back to you. Other thing, the only other thing I really want to talk about right now is in 2 weeks, Saturday, June 7th, is a really big cleaning day here at the church. This is a big cleaning day, not a little cleaning day where we're going to lay some mulch and get rid of some leaves or something like that. This is a big cleaning day. We have two trailers in the back of our property that I'm sure many of you have seen. They are full of stuff. Some of the stuff is good, some of the stuff is junk and really old and messy. We're going to take everything, every last item out of those trailers, clean it up, clean in the trailers, and decide what's worth keeping and what we're going to get rid of, whether we sell it or give it away or trash it. We're not sure. We're going to have a project going on inside. We're going to be cleaning out attic spaces. We have a lot of work, and so if as many of you can come, we'll take you. We need help. This is one of those all hands on deck kind of moments where, you know, sometimes we just got to take care of the church grounds and all the different things that we've had and accumulated over the years. Myself and Pastor and John, we started this past week cleaning out the attic, and just the three of us, it was terrible. It was just absolutely horrendous. John is just sweating all over the place, and I'm at the bottom of the steps going up to the attic. My dad's at the top handing things down, and in that moment, I had a flashback to just a couple years ago. I guess it was almost 15 years ago. But 15 years ago, I was maybe 15 years old or about, and I was at the bottom of an attic staircase looking up to my father who loves me. He's in the attic handing boxes down. We were preparing to move to Pennsylvania, if I remember correctly. It was to come here. And so we're packing and packing. And as I reached for a box from my loving father, he kicked a pewter jar into my face that cut through my lip, and blood is everywhere. And I had stitches and all kinds of fun things. And he won the Dad of the Year award that year. And so I had a flashback to that moment, and I thought, I should not be here. I know better. I have learned. So I'm asking you fine people, please come. Stand at the bottom of the steps and see what happens. It'll be a good time. Hopefully, we will not have any hospital visits. But that's Saturday, June 7th. We're going to start like 9 a.m., and we're just going to go till it's done. Obviously, you can stay as long as you want. No requirement to stay really long, but we'll be working. I think we'll all be there. The staff will all be there, and it's going to be fun. So please let me know, actually, if you can make it to that. Just find me after service and say, hey, I'll be there, so I can kind of get an idea of how many people we can expect, and I can plan out the workload accordingly. Okay, good. Let's pray, huh? We're going to pray over our tithes and our offering here in just a second. I'm also going to pray over, about Memorial Day and honoring our fallen veterans. And we're also going to pray, as we do each week, for another local congregation. This week we're praying for the Holy Cross Greek Orthodox Church. So let's just bow our heads together. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for the faithfulness of this church. I thank you for your faithfulness as we prepare to give back to you and the offering of tithes and our finances and sacrificial gifts to you. I pray, Lord God, that you would take every cent given, that you would multiply it, O God, that you would work a miraculous feat this morning and take it further than it would otherwise go, and use it, Lord God, to impact souls in the Pocono Mountains. Use it to impact and affect hearts, Lord God, in every various ministry here at the church and also overseas as we support missionaries around this world. Lord God, and continue to bless and honor and favor your children who give today. I know that it is a great act of faith and sacrifice to give sometimes. And so bless them, Lord. Bless their obedience, I pray. Lord, I also pray for the Holy Cross Greek Orthodox Church. Lord, and as I even am honored to collect a tithe and even honored to collect an offering, honored to be a part of your working in this kingdom, I'm honored to stand alongside all the other local churches here in the Pocono Mountains. And this morning we pray for them, and we pray your blessing over them. I pray your favor upon their leadership, O God, that they would be given gifts of discernment, Lord God, and wisdom in leading that congregation as they strive, Lord God, to reach their community as you have called them to do. So let your spirit be with them, even this morning as they gather. Bless them, O God, and we thank you for them and their sacrifice and everything they do for your kingdom. And lastly, Lord, on Memorial Day, and in remembrance of Memorial Day, I pray for all those families, O God, the families of all those who have laid someone to rest in service for our great nation. I ask, Lord God, that in this time of remembrance, that they would only have peace and joyful memories, that they would look fondly on their loved ones. And as we all remember them together in honor, Lord God, that you would just bless them. And we thank you, and we thank them for the incredible sacrifice for our freedom. Lord, we find ourselves all combined together on an even playing field in so many areas, whether it's in finance and surrender to you, or in striving to serve you and in this great kingdom of God that we find ourselves, or even here just living as Americans side by side and honoring one another and supporting each other. We thank you. We thank you for each other. We thank you for this wonderful body that we're a part of. And we ask, Lord, as we surrender all these things, that you would bless them. Now in Jesus' name, amen.
Wisdom and the interpretation that was shared with us earlier. After we had the opportunity to return your tithes and offering, would you stand with us and we let us sing this song together here in your presence. Amen.
Heaven is trembling in awe of your wonder. Kings and their kingdoms are standing amazed, hearing your praise.
Yeah.
So did I freak you all out? I could tell you more. I will tell you that that song is going to be much more meaningful to me that we just sang. I never really thought of it as being about heaven. Is that what it's about? Or is it about his, where's Marco? Is that what it's about? Is that song about heaven? Yeah? It is now. It is now. It is for me. Well, we're at the conclusion of a series entitled Money Tales, and I've enjoyed bringing this series to you. Of course, Pastor Dawn did the best message of the series on Mother's Day, without a doubt. Please keep her in prayer. She's definitely under the weather. Almost seems like she's got a little bronchitis, but we'll see. We're getting her to a doctor today. But these are stories that Jesus told about money. He told a lot of stories about money. He spoke about it quite a lot because money can grab our hearts. Money can challenge us in ways that not many other things do. And so Jesus talked about it quite a bit. Whether it's, some of you say, well, I'd like to have more money to challenge my heart. You know, okay, I get that. But whether it's a little or it's a lot, it's something that we wrestle with, and Jesus wanted to direct our attention to it. I want to begin with a question, though. Do you ever feel that you're being pulled in a number of different directions all at once? You ever feel like, you raise your hands. I mean, you got this, but you got that. You got this responsibility, you know. Thank you, because I'm not the only one. Yeah, sometimes you just feel like you're really being pulled in different directions. You know, it's Memorial Day, and we're thinking, of course, of the families who have lost loved ones. And really, for America, it goes all the way back to the Revolutionary War. And all of the sacrifices have been made, people who have given their lives so we can have this freedom today. And most of those families are long gone, and we're not necessarily praying people into heaven. We don't know. Every person stands or falls before the Lord based on their faith in the Lord and their relationship with Jesus Christ. And we don't understand how everything connects, at least I certainly don't claim to, but I will say this, that the Lord wants us to honor those who have made that kind of a sacrifice, and he wants us to honor those who have families they've left behind because of the sacrifice they made. And I got just a taste of that, just a taste. I don't want to put myself in that category of people who have made that level of sacrifice, but I got a taste of it every time I was going on a deployment. If you're visiting with us today, you may not know that I had a career in the military, and I was a Navy chaplain. And one of the things in the Navy was when you're getting ready to pull out and that ship is leaving in the morning and you're going to be gone for a minimum of 6 or 7 months, you really don't always know exactly how long, and you've only been back for 3 weeks to a month before you had been gone out, you know, for 3-4 months before that, and it just continues this way. You really, in my case, we were gone more than we were home. Because it was a nuclear-powered ship, and, you know, you don't want to, you know, if you don't have to pay for the fuel, you just go. And we were all over the place and all over the world and involved in conflicts all around the world. But, you know, we finally got to a point where, with three children, where we would go the night before, and I would give up the night, my last night at home, I would give it up and I'd spend it on the ship. Because then I could say goodbye to the children, they'd bring me to the ship, they'd drive me, and I'd watch them drive away, all the hugs and kisses, and you see their faces through the window, and they're trying to look at you till the last minute, and they're waving out the windows, and they're gone. And then I get on the ship, and I have to put on my work face and my work heart and realize that I've got this commitment, and I've got to keep this commitment. Well, that's going on all the time with people in our armed forces and the separations that they have from their families in order to serve. Especially those who are married with families, as I was just mentioning in my own experience. And you talk about being pulled different ways. I'm thinking of the responsibility I have with my wife and my children. I'm thinking of the responsibility I have for my country and the commitments I've made. And you're really just pulled in two different directions. And I'm sure that we all face these challenges. Every person who has lived any kind of life where they've been involved in this world, and they're starting to get older, and they're starting to face the challenge of being pulled in two different directions. Sometimes your family responsibilities are pulling you one way, and your work is pulling you another way, and you need how much you need to generate. You know what the situation is financially. You know, maybe you have to get that extra part-time job in order to make ends meet, and so you have to balance that with less time with your kids or with your family, and we have these kinds of balancing acts that we have, and sometimes our friends are tugging at us one way, but our faith in Christ and our desire to be with a church, with a body of believers, is tugging at us with another way. And I haven't even gotten to our relatives, who are all kind of mixed in and thrown in and have their own influence in our lives. And so when this happens, we're often left wondering what is really important in this life. And that's really the question I want to address with this message. What is really important in this life? Because we're all getting tugged in different directions. So what is the highest priority? What is the thing that's most important? And this is true for Christians as well, because we're being pulled in two dramatically different ways. And Jesus taught specifically about this. And the story that we're going to look at today forces us to make a decision between one way or another way. What kind of life we want? Are we going to have a life that's dependent upon things, dependent upon what we can accumulate, upon what we can, gather for ourselves? Or we're going to have a life that may not have a lot of those things, but is rich with God? We have to make decisions. We have to make choices, because quite often you really can't have it all, and the Lord has set things up in such a way just for that reason. And the reason I even bring this up is that we as Americans, for the most part, at least it's certainly been my experience, we have a desire to accumulate as much wealth as we can so we can take it easy. We want to accumulate everything we can so we can work less, or so we can do less, or so we can have more vacation time, or we can take more time for ourselves. And I just think that this is part of the American psyche, that kind of American dream that you can have more. Now, I don't think that was the original American dream. I think the original American dream was that you can have the freedom to prosper yourself and do better for you and your children, and there's not going to be any government that's going to hold you down, that the government will support that decision. And try to bring you the freedom so that you can have a better life than you had anywhere else. That was the American dream. It kind of has become more of the dreams of the rich and famous. Have you ever watched any of those TV shows, like, the Lives of the Rich and Famous? Come on, be honest with me. How many, put your hands up if you've ever seen these shows. You see how certain people are living in the homes that they're building for X amount of dollars. There's one that I happened to flip on the other day. It was called Fabulous Wealthy Hideaways. And they were showing houses that were like, $20 million on their own private island with yachts that are worth $1 million, bringing them in and out. And I'm just thinking, this really stinks, you look at this and you say, come on, what's going on here? And because no matter how much you possess, and I'm blessed, and my wife and I have been blessed, and our kids are blessed, and we're just so thankful for everything, but there's always somebody that's got more, There's bigger and there's better, and that's just simply how it is. And in America, the distance between having enough or at least living a comfortable life and being really greedy doesn't always seem all that much. And so these are things that we need to address in this story, because in this story, Jesus is actually teaching on something that is incredibly important, but he's going to get interrupted. He's teaching on how we must fear God and fear God alone, to reverence and respect and honor the Lord, and to recognize how that's going to change our lives. And in the middle of his teaching, a man shouts out and interrupts him. Now, could you imagine, even here this morning, if someone just shouted out and interrupted me as I'm speaking, which I'm not suggesting that you do right now, Joe. But you'd kind of say, okay, what's going on? What is this part of the message? And I actually thought about planting someone. Joe, you would have been the right guy to plant. But this is no plant. This is just a guy who shouts out and interrupts Jesus, and he's dissatisfied. You know, it's amazing. Jesus is teaching on the most profound subject, and this guy is just seething inside because he didn't get enough of the inheritance. His brother got more than he got, and he wants Jesus, because rabbis would sometimes get involved in this stuff. Rabbis might get involved in secular things, in issues of the courts, and so it wasn't totally unusual, but Jesus is teaching. He's got a crowd of people gathered around. His disciples are learning and listening. And this guy just shouts out and says that there's something unfair going in my life. I can't hear anything else you've got to say, because this, what's going on in my own head is so loud. Have you ever been there? And that's what's happening in this particular moment in the life of Christ and in the life of his disciples. I personally find it kind of comforting to know that Jesus could not keep everyone's attention. You know, because I've experienced that right here in this place, where I think, you know, this is good, and I'm watching people, you know, and I just shout it out when you're getting, just say, I'm tired, it's time for you to end, you know, or something like that. I get it, I understand, but you got to wait at least another 15, 20 minutes before you do that. So this is what's happening in this situation. The guy's just dissatisfied. In fact, let's look at it. It's found in Luke's Gospel, chapter 12. It's in verse 13. He says, teacher, or rabbi, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. And I can just imagine the Lord's facial expression at this moment. At least I could certainly imagine what mine would be doing. Because this guy has no idea as to how inappropriate he's being. I get it that some families have really been disrupted and injured by just this kind of thing, the distribution of assets. Sometimes one family member won't speak to another family member for years, even decades, because of the pain it has caused in regards to how money was distributed amongst the children, perhaps, when the parents were gone. And I want you to notice, this guy, he doesn't really ask Jesus to make a decision between him and his brother. He is demanding something from Jesus. Tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. And Jesus responds, man, who made me a judge or an arbitrator over you? You know, Jesus usually said things like, dear friend or brother. This is like, hey, man, who made you? What is going on with you that you're interrupting me? At least that's how I would take it. And I just find it fascinating. He refuses to get involved in this guy's legal debate or legal judgment, and he goes right to the moral issue, right to the heart of the matter. Because what he, I believe, knows is that a family feud over this kind of inheritance, it's only a symptom of a bigger problem. And that bigger problem we today call greed. I didn't get my fair share. I should get more. Or I should have more. Or I need more. Or my children need more. I need it so I can give it to my children. That seems a little nicer, a little more adult. But I should have more, somehow. And it didn't happen. I didn't get what I feel was my fair share. And Jesus uses the word in verse 14. He said, who made me a judge or an arbitrator over you? And I was surprised to discover that in the original language, which of course was Greek, Jesus actually spoke in Aramaic, but when it was translated into the Greek, which we have today, that word you is actually plural. So my guess is he's speaking not only about this man, but he's speaking about his brother too. Who made me a judge over you and your brother? Who made me an arbiter between the two of you? Because there's a deeper issue. It's an issue of the heart that isn't being addressed. And as long as you two brothers are suffering from this issue of the heart, which deals with greed, no settlement is going to be satisfactory. And yet, Jesus stops everything he was doing. He was teaching very strategically to the crowd and to the disciples, and he shifts gears to respond to this guy, and in so doing, he teaches us all a lesson about our hearts, because that's really what's in play right here. I mean, consider this. How often have we gone to God asking him to change our situation, what we're going through, rather than asking him to change our hearts? Change that person, change this situation, do something in regards to that, make that happen, but we never ask him to change us. We never ask him for a heart change. Perhaps our prayer should be, God, here is my problem. Please change my heart. Why don't you say that with me? God, here is my problem. Please change my heart. Now, that's a very interesting prayer. And it leads us to what we're really getting into with this message from Jesus. He says to them, and he said to the man, but he's now addressing the crowd, I believe, in verse 15, take heed and beware of covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he possesses. And I think they would know that. They knew the Old Testament. The Old Testament had a lot to say about that. There's a difference between the godly and the ungodly. The godly who are God-centered in their lives, seeking to live a life that is pleasing to God. The ungodly, of course, not interested. Whatever they say they are, they're really not interested in pleasing God, not living a life that's seeking to honor God. They're simply living for themselves. Proverbs 21, verse 26, I'm sure they knew this. Speaking of the ungodly, they're always greedy for more, while the godly love to give. There's something about being self-focused where you're always trying to gain. You're always trying to get more. It's never quite enough. Where the person who is God-focused, the scripture is saying, is receiving from God and giving. Receiving from God and giving to others. Releasing that which the Lord has entrusted into that person's care. So it's a completely different kind of life, a different quality of life. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 10. I'm going to come back to this book later and explain something about it. But here, let me just read what it says. Those who love money, those who are centered on money, will never have enough. How absurd to think that wealth brings true happiness. But isn't that exactly what most Americans think? I mean, we may not say it, but it's how our attention is laid out. It's how we spend our time, how we're seeking to gain more, how we divide, if you will, the amount of time we have on this earth, how much is spent in the desire to accumulate money. And you know, if we could just win the lottery, you know, or maybe someone come over with those big six-foot checks, what's that, the Publisher's Clearinghouse? You know, does anybody ever win with that? I don't know if anybody ever wins, but I see commercials from time to time. And boy, then everything would be great. We would be able to take it easy a little bit. Of course, you would give some money to the church, and so God should do this for you so you could give money to the church. Yeah. You know, it's just never enough. One pastor told a story that I never forgot. He talked about a shipwrecked sailor. And he's on a raft in the middle of the ocean, and you could imagine day after day without water, finally that salt water starts to look pretty good. And so, dying of thirst, he is compelled to drink the salt water, which, if you know anything about this, only makes you thirstier. And this causes him to drink more salt water, which indeed increases his thirst. So he consumes more and more salt water until, paradoxically, he becomes dehydrated and dies. So it is with greed. We want more, but in the accumulation of more, we're dying inside. We never become the person that God has designed us to be and intended us to be, nor live the life that he has called us to live. So Jesus decides to make up a story. I believe he made up this story on the spot. I can't prove it, but that's just how Jesus was. He makes up a story to make a point. Today, we call it the parable of the rich fool. And I believe Jesus gives us five consequences that happen when our hearts are focused exclusively on ourselves. That's the nature of greed. You say, well, I'm not a greedy person. Yeah, but how much time every day is your heart focused on you? Because that's what greed is. So let's look at this a little bit and see if we can understand the essence of greed in our own lives rather than thinking of someone else right now. First, the first consequence, that is, and we'll put it on the screen, when our hearts are focused on ourselves, we do not give God the credit for the things he has done. And this is in your notes as well on that connection card. And this is how Jesus starts the story in Luke chapter 12, verse 16. Then Jesus spoke a parable to them, saying, "The ground of a certain man yielded plentifully." Now, I believe he's speaking to the entire crowd now. I don't think he's trying to embarrass the guy who spoke to them. And he's going to speak of a rich man, and this rich man is a farmer. His ground is yielding plentifully. In other words, he's doing well in life. And in a sense, at least from this story, he represents us. He represents the human race, represents you, wherever you're at in your life, and the possibility of being seduced by greed, the desire to have more, to live towards yourself alone. And the farmer looks at this amazing harvest, and he never sees the hand of God. He only sees his own effort. And sometimes we look at these amazing lives we've been gifted with, and we see the work we've done, what we've put into it, but we don't see the hand of God. And we need to talk about that a little bit, because that's what this story is all about. This is a perfect example of what greed actually is. He has much, but he actually expects more. Let me give you a second consequence. When our hearts are focused on ourselves, we make plans, but we leave God out. We make plans, but we leave God out of those plans. Jesus goes on with the story in verse 17. And when he thought within himself, the farmer that is, he thought saying, "What shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops?" So he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns, build greater barns, and there I will store all my crops and goods." By the way, there's nothing wrong with trying to expand your business. Nothing wrong with trying to, invest in a business and trying to, hopefully you'll create some jobs for other people, and you'll have more money to use for the work of the kingdom of God if you're a follower of Jesus Christ. Nothing wrong with these things. We want to be wise. We want to be prudent with how we do this. The problem lies in the fact that this farmer has no thought of being generous at all. Everything is about him. Did you notice he says, "My crops, my barns, my goods"? Those are words that shouldn't belong in the life of a follower of Christ, those who are centered on the Father. This man is confused between ownership and stewardship, the same thing that you're confused about. Yeah, you and me. I have my car. Do you really? What if the Lord says, "Give that car to such and such a person"? Oh, no, 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 what? It's not even paid off yet. And I need it to pull my boat. Oh, you have a boat. I want that too. Give that to this guy. Oh, what am I going to do with my skis? You have skis? I have someone else I want you to give those to. Yeah, and we could go through everything we own, everything we have. And it all belongs to the Lord. We're stewards, we're managers of the Lord's wealth if we're truly followers of Christ. But we don't necessarily live that way. We maybe believe it, but it hasn't quite crept down into our hearts because we're still holding on to these things. They're ours. I've worked hard for these things. I've worked hard. I'm not going to have you say that because we think it. And that's how we live our lives. And I get that. And so, in a sense, what's going on with this man is what's going on in the church in America to a great extent. And that is this confusion between ownership and stewardship. His wealth was not his own. Rather, it was only on loan. Your wealth is not your own. It's only on loan to you. And we need to talk about that a little bit. It brings us to the third consequence. When our hearts are focused on ourselves, we consider spending our resources only on ourselves. If you do make budgets, what is in your budget for the work of the kingdom of God? What is in your budget for others? Have you so structured your budget that there's nothing left for what the Lord would like to do through you financially? It's just something to think about. Well, this is what this man is certainly addressing in the story, or Jesus is addressing it, but this man is helping us to understand it, the farmer. Verse 19, he says, I'll say to my soul, soul, you ever talk to yourself that way? Soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. I don't think he was thinking of his soul as in spiritual things. I think he's thinking of his physical body. He's thinking of how much comfort he can bring to himself, that he can enjoy more comfort in this life. And I'm going to work hard so I don't have to work and I can take it easy. And we call that retirement. And we can just relax and we can do all kinds of things that we were never able to do before. And it'll all be about me. It'll all be about what I can do for me. It'll be because I've earned it. That's the American way. It's just something to think about because there's something different that Jesus is trying to teach us. Because this guy thinks he's going to have it made for years to come. He envisions a future that's going to get better and better, but here's the key. It will be fully under his control. You know, in the New Testament, James wrote a letter. This is James, the half-brother of Jesus, actually the Lord's little brother, James, the son of Mary and Joseph. He's mentioned in some of the Gospels, but he wasn't one of the apostles. James, this James, not there's another one, James the apostle, who is the brother of the apostle John. John and James, those of you who know the scriptures know what I'm talking about, and if not, I'll help you to know right now. They're different people. But James, this one, actually thought Jesus was crazy, didn't have any real respect for him, and when he was speaking publicly, he and some of his brothers would try to tell him, you know, he needs to be locked up. And it wasn't until the resurrection of Christ that this James came to faith in his own older brother and realized he was actually the Messiah, the Son of God. By the way, little commercial. Pastor Nathan over at Clarity in Los Angeles, Clarity Church in Los Angeles, is preaching through the book of James right now. This morning he'll be doing part four of this series. I have listened to the first three parts and they are amazing. I'm so impressed and so blessed. And so I encourage you, just go to clarity.la, clarity.la. And you can download his, put it on your podcast, comes up automatically on mine. And I listen to his messages every week. But he's going through the entire book of James, which right now it's not on my schedule to do that. But if you listen to his messages during the week, he's only three into it, and he's going to be going all summer. I think it will be a blessing to you. Anyhow, James, in chapter 4 of his letter, verse 13, he says this. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city, spend a year there, buy and sell and make a profit. Whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. That's a powerful statement. Sounds just like his big brother right there. The Bible's not discouraging us from making plans or looking forward to the future that we can invest and see things happen, and we're hoping that will be the case, and we're thinking and using wisdom, and I get that. But in this case, what we're really looking at is a person who thinks that they're doing this and everything lies within their own control, making plans that are totally without any perspective of God. But for us as followers of Jesus Christ, we're saying, well, God is in control. In other words, we need to make every plan with humility. If I'm putting something on my calendar, I have things on my calendar a year in advance. But I know that I may not be alive a year in advance from this moment. I may not be around tomorrow. The Lord has taught me to number my days, to take note of how long I may be here and when I won't be here, and to be prepared to come into his presence and give an account. In other words, to plan with humility. Let me give you a fourth consequence. When our hearts are focused on ourselves, we store our treasure in the wrong place. I really want you to get this. We store our treasure in the wrong place. Verse 20. But God said to him, that is the farmer, God said to him, "Fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided?" In other words, who gets all the stuff? Fool, by the way, is not a description of some kind of mental strength or mental ability. The word is speaking about spiritual discernment. You have no spiritual wisdom. You don't understand the things of God. The psalmist put it this way in chapter 14, verse 1, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God." That's not calling someone a fool the way we use the word in modern English, "you foolish person." Being unkind. No, he's saying the person with no spiritual discernment, the person who has no center in God, who does not understand the things of the Lord, not interested in understanding the things of God or the ways of God, says in his heart, "There is no God." He's a fool because he has said not only that, but he's living as if God does not exist. There are a lot of Christians in America who are living as if God does not exist. We're living as if we might as well be atheists. In here, we're Christians, but in here, we're still functioning as atheists because we make all our decisions, we say all our words, we think all our thoughts as if God does not exist. Just something for us to consider, because this is what robs us of our peace and robs us of our testimony as followers in Jesus Christ and of our power to really make a difference in this generation. So he's a fool because he doesn't recognize that his material blessings come from God, nor does he feel that he has any obligation to try to help anyone out with the wealth that he has. So he just leaves God out of his life. So greed is often the result of believing, I think, that there's no life after death. In other words, grab everything you can get, because that's it. That's all you're going to have. I love this little story. It's a little Russian story from many years ago about a successful farmer, not unlike the one in our story today, but he's not satisfied. He wants more. He wants to build those bigger barns. And someone comes to him with an offer and says, "I will give you for 1,000 rubles." I do not know how much a ruble is, but the story says rubles. "I will give you for 1,000 rubles all the land you can get. Just walk as far as you can get and then come back here to the starting point. I'll give you all the land you can get for 1,000 rubles. The guy thinks this is an incredible deal. Imagine the price of land just here in the Poconos. If someone said, "Just walk and then come back to the starting point, go as far as you want to go, turn around and come back, and you can get it all for $1,000. Say, "Well, sign me up." So the next morning, that's exactly what happens. He's ready to go. And by the way, there is a proviso that you have to come back before the sun sets. You can only do it in that one day. And so he goes and he launches out and he's walking rather quick because you want to put on some miles before you turn around because you want a big ranch or something. You get as much land as you can get. And that's what this guy does. And he walks very, very far. And then he realizes that the sun is already starting to go down, and he hasn't turned around yet to go back. So he makes his loop, and he starts heading back. But he also discovers, as you might imagine, that he's walked too far, and he's not going to get back down. Not going to get back by sundown, which means not only will he not get any more land, but he's going to lose his 1,000 rubles. So he starts running, and he's running now for miles to try to get back in time before the sun sets. And he's watching the sun go down, and he's gasping for breath, and his heart is pounding, and every bit of strength that's left in his body is just about gone. And he finally, he gets there just as the sun is going down, and he crosses the starting line, which of course is now the finish line. And he plops down, exhausted, heaving. His friends and family come running over to him. They can't help him. And within a few moments, he's dead. Why are you laughing at that? That's not funny. Nasty people. So his friends dig him a grave. The grave is not much over 6 feet long and 3 feet wide. And the title of this story was, How Much Land Does a Man Need? I just got to think about it for a minute. To be a fool is to have missed the point of life. The remarkable thing is that this person that God calls a fool would in America probably be called a great success story. Jesus says, this very night, your soul will be required or demanded of you. To demand is to require back. The idea here is that life is a loan that must be repaid to God upon demand. That everything we have at some day, some point, no matter how old you are, no matter how young you are, that moment will come where the Lord will say, I'm demanding back what I have given you as a loan. And that's called this life. So the story continued with these words. Then whose will those things be which you have provided? In other words, who gets all the stuff? And I said I was going to come back to Ecclesiastes before we finish this teaching. But, you know, Ecclesiastes is a book that you got to warm up to. Solomon, King Solomon had gotten very old and he'd gotten very cynical. And he had given up so much, he'd made so many mistakes in his life. His life started out with such promise, and it just ended up so badly. Ultimately, the kingdom is, after he dies, the kingdom is divided and never comes back together. And, you know, it just doesn't work out well. He does build the great temple called Solomon's Temple, which is going to be destroyed centuries later by the Babylonians. So even that goes. So he's just cynical. And I think as you get a little older, you kind of warm up to the book of Ecclesiastes because you've been around and you've seen this and you've seen that and they've done that and they've done it. Yeah, I've been there. I hear, yeah, sure, okay. I saw that 20 years ago. So, you know, I think that's where he's at. And in chapter 2, verse 21, and we'll put it on the screen, he says, for though I do my work with wisdom, knowledge, and skill, in other words, I work hard. Even though I work hard, I must leave everything I gain to people who haven't worked to earn it. This is not only foolish, but highly unfair. So what do people, in other words, like me, what do people like me get for all their hard work? Their days of labor are filled with pain and grief and the sacrifice and the struggle to gain and to accumulate. Even at night, they cannot rest, always thinking of how they can do better and build the business or create more wealth. And it's all utterly, say it with me, meaningless. Meaningless? How can you say that in America? This is what it's all about. This is why we're here, to accumulate more wealth, to generate more wealth. I've heard people say that you're not even patriotic unless you've generated wealth. And I suppose I can agree if it's about creating jobs and then being generous and being part of the work of the kingdom of God. But that's usually not what's being said. But I don't know people's hearts. But since you can't take it with you, there's no need, according to Solomon, to wear yourself out accumulating more than you need. Because everything that you have is one day going to be left behind. So it's yours now. You can use it for the work of the kingdom of God, or you can abuse it and use it entirely upon yourself. But one day it will be taken from you, and you will stand before the Lord and give an account for how you used it. Because this life is on loan to you and will eventually be demanded back. And with that cheerful thought, I want to bring you to the fifth consequence. When our hearts are focused on ourselves, again, remember, that's greed. We will find ourselves in conflict with God's plan for our lives. And so Jesus concludes in verse 21, so is he, just like the farmer, so is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. All the treasure, all the riches, all the wealth that we can ever accumulate in this world have one major weakness, They have no purchasing power after death. Once you die, they have no value. However, he says there's something different about being rich toward God. Now, I don't know exactly what that means. I'm going to try to define it before we conclude, but I think it has something to do with what I said earlier, that the Lord can pour into our lives so we can pour into other people's lives, so we're a part of the solution instead of part of the problem. Numerous examples of people like this in the Bible. Right here in Luke's gospel, we have examples of it, and this is what Jesus has, the recording is all done by the historian named Luke, who was a physician, Dr. Luke. And he talked about a centurion, a Roman centurion, part of the occupying force who built a synagogue for people to worship in. Just built it because he wanted to give something back to these people. In Luke chapter 10, we hear about the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, how they always opened it up to Jesus. But remember, Jesus traveled with what today we would call an entourage, okay? He had his posse with him. He had everything except probably the paparazzi and all the, you know, all of the photographers who might be chasing him down. Huh? There are probably people like that too. They had chisels and stones. Oh, never mind. But when they made their home available, they made their lives available. And maybe some of you do the same. You make your homes available to others because you recognize that that home is on loan to you to use for the purpose of the King of Kings, whatever purpose he has for you. Whatever we own, actually he owns. And so there's this sense of generosity that we find in the scripture. So the question, how do we become rich toward God? Well, I think there's just two things. One we've been talking about, but I think the first thing is that we live according to his will. And let me rephrase that. We live as his will. Because you got to keep in mind, for people who are truly born of the Spirit, and I hope that's every one of you, we have died. We've gone down into death. Imagine with me just for a moment that you've died. And you're in heaven. And I got a glimpse of that last night. I will always believe I got a glimpse of something that was real in this dream. And you don't. I didn't want to leave. But the Lord comes along, and this was not in my dream, but let's suggest the Lord comes along and says, I have a mission for you, Charles. I'm going to send you back. And I wake up. Maybe I was in an accident. I'm on the operating table. Whatever it may be, I wake up, and I look around, and I now get back to health, and I realize I'm on mission. I am on mission. That's what a Christian is. A follower of Christ is someone who has died in Christ, been raised up in Jesus Christ, and you've been sent into this world to do the work of the kingdom of God. We are on mission, as compared to many Americans who go to churches because they're looking for a church that will meet their needs, rather than to be a part of a Christian community that is on mission, doing the things that God has called us to do. That's the will of God. The will is to be the will of the Father. Jesus was the will of the Father. If you saw Jesus, you saw the will of God. I want people to say the same thing about you. I met Mary the other day, and I met the will of the Father operating through her life. I met Victor the other day, and the will of the Father was speaking through him and hearing my voice and encouraging me and supporting those around him. I could see the will of the Father operating through him. This is how you become rich toward God. And then second, I'd say, by investing whatever we are, all that we are, into the kingdom, into the church, and into people. All people belong to the Lord. Well, let me finish this up, and we'll head on out because we all want to get ready to start burning hamburgers for Memorial Day. At least that's what happens at my house, I'm afraid to say. But I began this teaching by suggesting that many of us are pulled in different directions. And I think you would agree that we all go through this. And if we're not aware of what's happening, we could begin to wonder what is really important in this life. And I think in this story, and I wanted to conclude this entire series with this story because I think the answer is found here in verse 21. Let me read it to you again. Who is a fool? That's really what this is about. Who is a fool? So is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. How many of you have heard of the missionary Jim Elliot? Jim Elliot, a lot of hands going up. God bless you. The man's with the Lord. He gave his life as a missionary. He was brutally killed by people he was trying to bring the gospel to, but ultimately all of those people came to know Christ. As the wives of Jim Elliot and the rest of the team went back to continue to share the gospel, and they couldn't understand how these women would come back, instead of just grieving and getting filled with hate, they went back to share the gospel, and an entire civilization was affected through the sacrifice of this man and his missionary team. But we remember his name because he said these words: "He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose." And in spite of all of life's complexities and all the challenges that we face, ultimately it can all be reduced to one very simple decision. Are you going to live your life toward yourself, or are you going to live your life toward God? That's the stewardship of life. And the day will come where what's been given to us on loan will be demanded back. Father, I thank you because you do all things well. And we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus, that you would speak into our hearts right now. As we prepare to go our separate ways, we recognize that this has been a gathering of people who are hungry to know you better. It's been an opportunity to sit in your presence, to worship, and perhaps even to come a little bit undone. Because we have everything buttoned up. We have everything accounted for. Father, we've got all of the boxes checked and all of the T's crossed and all of the I's dotted. And there just doesn't seem to be any room for you, Lord, because, we got it handled. But Lord, sometimes we just come undone and we realize that at that moment that we've been fooling ourselves. We haven't really been honest. Perhaps what we've really been is greedy, covetous, just desiring more for more's sake, and not really being about the work that you've called us to do, not really continuing in the mission that you designed us for. There will come a time when we will be with you in eternity, and it will be amazing. But this is the season of work. It's the season of being still and knowing that you are God, and then allowing the work of your Holy Spirit to operate through us to do wonders. Lord, this is the season to watch the hand of God move in our lives. Help us not to miss it, but rather to be rich toward you, to be filled with your presence, and to desire above all things your purpose to unfold in our lives. And we thank you for this, and we ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You know, it's an amazing thing. If we preached nothing but Jesus from the pulpits in America, I wonder how full the churches would be. Or whether there would be a shifting where there would be certain people leaving and saying, that's not what I signed up for, but others being drawn because they get it, that there's a mission, there's a purpose, and there's a plan behind what we're doing. Well, I have a job now. Today and really tomorrow, I will burn some hamburgers. I am a terrible cook. I just don't do well. But everyone will say to me after the meal, "Wow, Charles, you did a great job." When actually it would be Dawn who did everything, prepared all the food, put it all out, and all I did was burn the meat. Isn't that how it works when the guys grill? It's as it should be. I'm just going to ask you tomorrow, if you do have the opportunity and you have the day off and you're going to be celebrating Memorial Day, maybe you just get together with those that you are gathering with and pause. Join hands for a moment and pray for the families who have lost loved ones. Just here in America, there's been over 6,000 in the last decade who have given their lives. It's a lot of families. That's a lot of moms and dads, husbands, wives, children. It's a lot. Who's praying for them? We can't get so busy eating the burgers or the ribs or the hot dogs, whatever it is, that we forget that we have the freedom to do this because of the sacrifice of so many. Amen? And then I would encourage you above all things, and if I could sum up this entire series of teachings that we've just finished, be rich toward God. Because that's something that'll keep you for eternity. If you're here and you're saying, I've never really drawn close to God, I don't know what it is to be a Christian, why don't you come on up over here when we dismiss, which we're going to do here in just a moment. We would love to give you some information. We have books that we give out. I talk about this quite often. One is called More Than a Carpenter, about Jesus. Another one is Christianity for You. You can take your pick. If you have to, you can have both. But typically, we give you one or the other. They're both great books. And they'll help you as you're trying to figure out what to do next. And any way we can help you answer any of the questions that you're wrestling with, we would love to do that. And so those books and talking with someone about it is over on this side. So you just come on over right here in the front. If you want to come and enjoy the Lord's Supper before you leave, you can do that. Take a few moments. And maybe when you do it, you could say, "Lord, my heart's desire is to be rich toward You." Amen? Let's stand together. And Father, we thank You for this wonderful Memorial Day weekend where we remember those who have sacrificed everything for us. But we're reminded above all of the Son of God who gave His life that we might have eternal life. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Father, for sending Your Son. Thank You, Holy Spirit, for making this real within our lives here today and every day as we go about our daily decisions and choices, and we recognize in all of these things that we want to be rich toward You. And we thank You for that. Bring Your blessing upon Your people. And now may the Lord bless you. May the Lord be gracious unto you. May the Lord give you peace. May the Lord lift up His countenance unto you. That is, may He smile when you come into His presence. And may the Lord give you shalom. Peace, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And everyone said, amen. Amen. God bless you all. Bye-bye now.